sedimentology and diagenesis with respect to the reservoir development of Mississippian Midale Beds in the Pinto-Roche Percee area of southeast Saskatchewan.
Fight the crowds just to get up here. Laser pointer, forward, backwards.
Okay, wait.
Cool. Oh yeah, you got this.
Wait, which one? Back, forward. This one's forward.
No, not
this
big
forward.
Honking one there.
Okay.
Cool beans. Can you see notes over there?
Do you want me to turn this?
Okay. I think I'll be okay.
Oh, you got that.
Yeah. So thank you for everyone who's sticking around, even though I know coffee break is coming up pretty shortly. First off, I'd just like to thank the organizing committee. They've done a great job at the CORE conference this year. And so I'm going to take us back to Saskatchewan, as John was talking about a couple talks ago. And I'll be discussing the sedimentology and diagenesis with respect to reservoir development of the Mississippian Midale Beds in the Pinto-Roche Percee area in southeastern Saskatchewan. So this is part of my master's research, which is sort of ongoing right now at the University of Regina under the supervision of Dr. Hiro Ching. So first off, I'd just like to thank both the U of R and the Saskatchewan Geological Survey for the financial support they've given me in my research, as well as to all the staff and geologists at the Saskatchewan Subsurface Geological Lab. So just a brief outline of what I'm going to be going over, a little bit of background info, and then I'll be covering my objectives and project area, followed by my facies associations, diagenesis, reservoir potential, and then end with some preliminary conclusions and future work. So as John stated earlier, we're going to be in the Williston Basin, which is of course the center of the universe, as it encompasses Saskatchewan, Manitoba, North Dakota, South Dakota, and Montana. So it's approximately 250,000 square kilometers and is a great source of hydrocarbons. Here on the right-hand side, we have our paleogeography of the early Mississippian, and just outlined is Saskatchewan. So looking at our southeast Saskatchewan stratigraphy, we have here the Mississippian-Madison group, and the Midale Beds are located here at the bottom of the Charles Formation. The Midale can be further subdivided into our Frobisher evaporite, and then the Midale carbonate, which is once again subdivided into the upper and lower Midale. So I have two main objectives of what I'm looking at. The first is to achieve a better understanding of the reservoir development within my study area. And I'm doing that by looking at the lithology, facies, and diagenetic history. From there, I'll be comparing the nature of the Midale reservoirs in this area to that of the pools a little further north, closer to the subcrop, such as the Steelman and the Weyburn. So to help get a better visual of that, I have a map here of the oil pools in southeast Saskatchewan. The two pools that I'm looking at are down here, the Pinto and Roche Percee. So actually right here, oh gosh, it's the Canada-US border. And then in this black line here, that's our subcrop edge. So you can see the Steelman and Weyburn are much closer to it. So here in the Williston Basin, we have the two pools. On the right-hand side is the Pinto. It has a little more than 500 wells, with about 300 of them producing from the Midale Formation. And then the Roche Percee over here, less wells, about 60, and only one is actually producing from the Midale Formation. So these are the 11 wells that I've been looking at with CORE. All of them are very close to the border. The two I have on display are this one here from the Pinto, the 816, and the 1622 from the Roche Percee. So after I've used all of these 11 wells for basically looking at core to get my facies interpretations and initial correlations, I've been using the logs from the other wells in the area to help correlate the stratigraphy. Here we just have the well production data of the 11 wells. We have the 6 Pinto wells all producing from the Midale. Not necessarily the best production. So I think what I'm also looking at within my study is to see if there's the opportunity to see if the right facies are being looked at and perfed. Here we just have the stratigraphy based on our well logs. So you can see the distinct lithological changes between the evaporite down here of the Frobisher evaporite followed by the Midale carbonate, and then once again followed by the Midale evaporite. So within the Pinto-Roche Percee area, we have 3 distinct lithologies which can be identified, and that would be your anhydrite, limestone, and dolostone. So within these lithologies, facies can be identified based on your skeletal assemblage and your sedimentary structures. And paleo environments can be determined based on other factors such as pelloids, oncoids, and intraclasts, which also help give insight into the energy levels of the area. So a thing to note is that our anhydrite facies, those are all stratigraphically representative of either the Frobisher or Midale evaporite. Your limestones, those would be your lower Midale carbonate, and then the dolostone is the upper Midale carbonate. So here is one of the wells that I have displayed. This is from the Pinto area. So just a comparison of how the core would line up with what we see in logs. And as well with our facies, we have that anhydrite at the bottom, followed by your limestone, and then your dolostone. Same thing within our Roche Percee core. You start with that anhydrite at the bottom, followed by the limestone. However, within the Roche Percee area, there's no distinct dolostone unit, and it's all capped by that Midale evaporite. So what's the environment that all these facies are found in? So we're looking here at a carbonate ramp where we move from our shallow open marine to subtidal, followed by your barrier and washover facies, and then to your lagoon, tidal flats, and sabka. So from the 11 facies that I've identified, I've broken them down into 3 different facies associations. The first one here we have is the mid-ramp, and that consists of your shallow open marine and subtidal. So seen in core, these would be examples of those facies. We have L1, this is your crinoidal fossiliferous packstone grainstone, and this would be the deepest water facies seen within the core. So you can notice these dark gray mud lenses, and as well within thin section, you have about 1 millimeter size crinoid fragments. Our next 2 facies would be representative of the subtidal area, and that's your L2 and L6, your fossiliferous waxstone and waxstone packstone. And within thin section, you can see the preservation of these very thin bivalves. So that would be an indicator of a lower energy environment than that of our L1. The next facies association that we have is the shallow ramp, and that consists of our barrier and washover deposits. In core, that would be represented by the L4 and L5, which is either a pelloidal or oncoidal intraclastic waxstone packstone. And in these thin sections, you can see here the nice microtized oncoids and some pelloids here, and the intraclast, all of those have been microtized. As well, it's also very prominent. You have this metasomatic anhydrite, which is seen both in core and in thin section. Our third and final facies association is the back ramp, and that consists of your lagoon, tidal flats, and sabka. So these are both your dolomite and anhydrite facies. In core, first off, your lagoon environment would be that of the D2, the dolomitic mudstone waxstone. In thin section, you have these smaller dolomites, as well as these quite a high abundance of bivalves, which are still preserved. Following in the tidal flat environment, you have the laminated dolostone, and in thin section, there are still some anhydrite veins which are present. Next up, we have both of our anhydrites, A1, the nodular mosaic anhydrite, and A2, the interbedded laminated and mottled anhydrite. So these would be representative of your sabka environment. And for A2, this could also be a shallow playa lake. So here we just have a cross-section. These are the 6 Pinto wells which I have. And it just shows sort of your sea level rise and fall sequences as we start with down here, your Frobisher evaporite. And then we move up into your more shallowing, your shallow water facies, followed by this kind of darker blue one here, which is the deepest water facies, and then we shallow upwards back again into the dolostone, and all of that is capped off by this Midale evaporite and hydrite unit. So throughout the core, there are many diagenetic processes which are seen. However, I'm just going to focus on the two which have the greatest effect on the reservoir. So within the lower Midale carbonate, the diagenetic feature that is most prominent and would affect our reservoir is that of the calcite cementation. So you can see these calcite crystals here which have formed in that pore space. And so the presence of the calcite cement has a very poor effect on reservoir quality, as it basically plugs up your porosity and permeability. So this example here is from the L1 facies. And then within the upper Midale carbonate, the diagenetic feature and process which we see, which is most prominent, would be that of dolomitization. So you have these nice rhombs of dolomite formed here, and this would have a positive effect on your reservoir. So just showing a couple more thin section examples from the upper Midale carbonate, you can see the different sort of degrees of dolomitization. This one example here, you still have in red, because these have been stained, all of the red stuff is still calcite, so your bivalves are still calcite, as opposed to this example here, where you have a much higher degree of dolomitization occurring. So if we look at the reservoir characteristics in terms of average porosity versus permeability plotted on a graph, you can see that D2 up here has quite good characteristics, as it has over an average of over 16% porosity and over 1.2 millidarcies. So, and the lowest one here is the L1. And that would be most likely due to the high amounts of calcite cement which are found within that facies. So as of now, I just have a preliminary comparison to the other fields. Here we have some core pictures from the Steelman and Weyburn. And you can see there's some prominent features such as the vuggy porosity, desiccation cracks, as well as this pink nodular anhydrite. So these features are not seen at all within the Pinto and Roche Percee area that I'm looking at. And this is most likely due to the fact that there's no subaerial exposure in the pools, whereas there's quite prominent subaerial exposure within the Steelman and the Weyburn. So I just have a few preliminary conclusions. Basically, the area I'm looking at is dominated by shallow marine facies in a ramp setting. Within those 11 lithofacies identified, they can be broken down into 3 facies associations. And subaerial exposure is a major factor in the difference between the fields further north to that closer to the border south. And diagenesis of the Midale carbonate is a primary factor in influencing the reservoir quality, whether it's either calcite or anhydrite cement or dolomitization. And we have several facies which exhibit pretty decent reservoir characteristics, and that would be your dolomite facies or that of your L4 and L5, and those are your barriers, and L2. So in terms of future work, I'll be examining some more core within the Pinto and Roche Percee fields, as well as determining the paragenetic sequence and doing a more detailed comparison of the Weyburn and Steelman fields to that of the Pinto and Roche Percee. So thank you, and if there are no questions, you can all go for coffee break now.
Does anyone have some questions at all? If not, I might put one out there.
Okay.
I know. Did you see in any of those faces that you looked at, was there in the work when you're reviewing, were there any that clearly showed that maybe they had been missed in previous work and maybe there was a lot of bypass pay potential or re-stimulation potential?
Well, I think, so one of the interesting things, I guess, is with the two fields I'm looking at, the Roche Percee, there's only that one well, which is producing from the Midale. And if it's based on just sort of, we're looking at the porosity and permeability within the two, there is a decent amount within the Midale in the Roche Percee area, which hasn't, I don't think, really been looked at too hard, maybe. So I think that it has possible potential.
Wonderful, thank you. So if anyone wants to see Celine's talk, it's on tables 27 and 28, sorry, core, not talk, we just saw it. 27 and 28 right behind us in the private room right here.
Oh yes, definitely feel free to check that out. I feel like everyone just rips on by as they go to the talk, so.
So please swing by, and with that we'll end. We're going to our morning break right now, and which is sponsored by Core Labs. So grab some coffee, maybe some donuts, and we'll be starting again up at 10:30 with deriving mineralogy and reservoir properties in the oil sands using XRF by Tom Sweetmark. Thanks, guys.